Blackstone Audio presents Solo Pass by Ronald De Feo. This book is read by Sean Runnette. Part 1. I thought that I looked ready now, so I asked for a solo pass. To my surprise, they agreed. Tomorrow would be the day. It began to feel like an event, which was understandable, because I hadn't been outside by myself in nearly 2 months. It could just as well have been 2 years. I had asked twice before, but the doctors had said no, claiming that I wasn't quite ready. Now, I suppose they considered me ready enough, though in some ways I felt much the same as I did when I wasn't, except for a tinge of calmness and control that had come over me unexpectedly, strangely, in recent days. The old feelings were still there, the old thoughts and fears, the anger. But more often than not, I was able to ignore them, or at least stop them before they got out of hand. I didn't push things. Some patients, when they're ready for a solo pass, ask for a whole day on the outside. But I told Dr. Peterson, who's been following my case ever since I arrived at Essex and was sent up to the mental ward, that I'd leave after lunch and be back around 6, just in time for supper. Fine, she said, no problem. Make a good half day of it. You could tell that she was impressed by such a conservative, mature plan. Yes, I've learned to understand their thinking and how to impress them, which, according to my roommate Carl, is the first big step toward getting out of here for good. Carl should know. He goes mad periodically, and has been in and out of this place, as well as in and out of other mental wards and hospitals throughout the city. He thinks of them as specialized hotels. "And this is one of the best," he said. "Nice rooms, wall-to-wall carpeting, decent food. I give it 4 stars. As he sees it, there's only one problem. It's easy to check in, but not so easy to check out. Carl used to be the manager of the appliance department of a big department store. At work, he would wear a white carnation in his lapel, the mark of an executive. There isn't anything he doesn't know about refrigerators or washers or dryers. Ask him about toasters and microwave ovens, and he can go on for hours. Once I told him that the inside of my metal coffee pot at home was so stained and corroded that it had a lethal look about it, that you drank its contents at your own risk, and that I really had to invest in a new one. Well, he must have rattled off a dozen or so brands, describing both the regular sort of pot and the kind you plug in, citing the positives and negatives, the features and capacity of each. I was very impressed. Too bad that depression often gets the better of him. A kind of visiting darkness and despair. He simply doesn't understand, and doesn't have the power to evict. The crisis came one day when he was demonstrating a food processor to a customer and began, for no particular reason, to weep. He couldn't stop weeping, sank down to the floor, and was eventually carried off by 2 security people. They tried to calm him, but soon realized that it was hopeless, and called for an ambulance. That was 5 years ago. He's been in and out of work and in and out of hospitals ever since. I suppose there's no good explanation for why one mind suddenly goes off while another holds firm. Apparently, some minds are weaker than others, more sensitive and breakable. And I suppose it's best that they are in the minority, or else the streets would be filled with lunatics. Although I was concerned about going out, I wasn't as concerned as I might have been. After all, I'd been out a few times before on a group pass, where you join other patients and are led by nurses or aides and can walk only a few blocks from the hospital. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.